Good evening, welcome to Off Topic Podcast and to our special edition named How I Met Honduras. In this first part of our section, Honduras, a conflicting history, where we study the history of this rich and interesting nation from a different angle, we will go from independence to the beginning of the 20th century with a huge turn of events that will mark politics for the rest of our history. 1807, Napoleon Bonaparte is in full bloom, and after being an ally to the Spanish Empire for years, he decides to invade Spain as a ghost, until in 1808 he makes King Fernando VII abdicate from the throne, and instead he puts José the First Bonaparte. This did not suit the Spanish people, who did not recognize him as their king. They thought of him as an invader, and instead decided to rebel against him. Years and years of conflict led to the creation of the new and innovative Cadiz Constitution, with such features as the universal suffrage, national sovereignty, press liberty, separation of powers, repartition of land, and many, many more for just a few years of rebellion. Nevertheless, even though it may seem as a great idea at first, they would promptly see their empire collapse, because with this constitution the criollos lost their privileges, the taxes augmented, and created huge movements against the Spanish in the American colonies, firstly in El Salvador, then in Guatemala, and in 1821 the opportunity came to Honduras, and on the 15th of September 1821, Honduras was declared independent with a constitution written by José Cecilio del Valle. Valle thought that Honduras was not ready for independence, but since all of the forces of power insisted, he decided to be the one to write the Act of Independence and the Constitution so the transition would be as smooth as possible. But, as we are going to see, Valle was right, because after independence, things started to get messy. First, with the country annexing to Mexico, just 2 months after declaring their independence, the country, along with the rest of Central America at the time, annexed to Mexico. This was proposed to Gavino Gaínza by Agustín de Iturbide, arguing that Central America lacked the necessary elements to ensure its autonomy, to free itself from foreign threat, and to constitute itself as a nation. The question of annexation to Mexico caused divisions within each of the provinces, since some cities were in favor and others against it. For example, in Honduras, Comayagua pronounced itself in favor of the annexation. Tegucigalpa, in turn, was opposed to it, since a new form of government should be decided by the Congress that would meet in 1822. In spite of the different opinions, the Provisional Consultative Board opted for the annexation to Mexico becoming effective on January 1, 1822, but on July 1, 1823, the absolute independence of Central America was decreed, declaring that the provinces were free and independent from Spain, Mexico, as well as from any other foreign power. The name United Provinces of Central America was adopted. Let's jump backwards to October 3rd, 1792 in Tegucigalpa, Honduras, the day and place where General José Francisco Morazán Quesada was born. Despite what many Salvadorians might say to you, his parents were José Eusebio Morazán Alemán and Guadalupe Quesada Borjas, both members of an upper-class criollo family dedicated to commerce and agriculture. For the most part, he was a self-taught man. In 1808, José Francisco moved with his family to Moroselí, El Paraíso, where he worked on the land inherited by Don Eusebio Morazán. He also had the opportunity to work as an employee of the mayor's office. 1813 was the year where his family moved to Tegucigalpa. Once there, Mr. Eusebio placed his son under the tutelage of León Vázquez, who taught him civil law, criminal procedure, and notary. At the same time, he had the opportunity to learn to read French in the library of his uncle-in-law, Dionisio Herrera. which allowed him to become familiar with the works of Montesquieu, The Social Contract of Jean-Jacques Rousseau, and the French Revolution. Now that we got a bit of context, let's jump forward to 1821. Those times just after the independence when Morazan enrolled in the military where he created a career, to then in 1827 become president of Honduras. But to tell you this story quicker, I shall tell you this with the power of comedy. Morazan had a bold idea to create a federation that would unite all Central American countries. Imagine a single nation with a strong government, but as in any good comedy, things never go as planned. The Central American Federation began with great enthusiasm, but soon became a real mess. Politicians argued and fought like monkeys over banana, and there were no bananas in the Central American plantations yet. Morazan tried to impose progressive reforms, but the local elites resisted tooth and nail. There were more intrigues and betrayals than in any episode of Game of Thrones. Even Central American soap opera writers ran out of ideas for their scripts. But Morazan would not give up. Nothing would stop him in his quest for unity. Well, except an army of opponents who overthrew him. It was as if they had taken the throne from a king who didn't even want to become king. Ironies of politics, right? Poor Morazan ended up exiled and finally captured and executed with a tragic end for our hero in 1842. It seems that in Central America, fate has a twisted sense of humor. Well, let's continue with the next part of history. By mid to late 19th century, Manuel Bonilla, a charismatic young man, was born into a humble family in Tegucigalpa. From an early age, he demonstrated a fierce determination and an unwavering desire to excel in politics. But his road to power would not be easy as he faced numerous obstacles and formidable enemies. Rosa Sierra, a beautiful young woman from a prominent political family, became the love of Manuel Bonilla's life since they met in their youth. Their love blossomed in the midst of a tumultuous political and social context in Honduras. In their youth, the two shared an affiliation with the Liberal Party, a progressive and reformist political movement in Honduras. However, as Manuel Bonilla rose through the party and forged his own path through leadership, tensions and personal ambitions began to emerge between them. Rosa's love became a conflict of loyalties when her own brother, Terencio Sierra, also a prominent member of the Liberal Party, fell out with Manuel Bonilla due to political differences and personal rivalries. Rosa found herself at the center of this love triangle and had to face difficult decisions between her brother and the man she loved. As political tensions increased, Manuel Bonilla made the decision to leave the Liberal Party and found his own political party, the National Party of Honduras, with the goal of challenging the established power and seeking his own path to the presidency of Honduras with a conservative but more stable vision. This decision further deepened the rift between Manuel and Rosa. Despite their love for each other, political circumstances and family loyalties seemed to drive them further apart. Over the years, Manuel Bonilla and Rosa Sierra met at different moments in their lives, some full of passion and others marked by distance and disagreement. Despite the adversities, they could never forget their love and the impact they had on each other's lives. The story of Manuel Bonilla and Rosa Sierra is a mixture of love, politics, and struggle for power. Their complicated relationship and the political tensions that surrounded them are intertwined in the history of Honduras, leaving an indelible mark in the lives of both and in the history of the country. Well, that is all for today in this first part of our History of Honduras section from the Up Topic podcast, in this special edition called How I Met Honduras. Tune in with us next time where we shall discuss the 20th century in history mining companies, banana companies, and a war on its demand. My name is Alejandro Pineda, and I was your host for today. See you next time!